In the merciless heat of Iraq, a Muslim-majority country that has been victim to various sorts of imperialism and has suffered several years of war and grave economic conditions, tens of millions of people gather annually in one location.
Quite amazing, to be honest. I have literally no words for it, but it was really amazing. Really, I have no words for it.
When I came for the first time, 3-day walk, it just left its depths in my heart. So I wanted to do the walk again.
I didn't feel like that I'm walking. I felt like I'm going to meet my Imam Husayn alayhi salam.
We often speak about Tawheed. It's easy for me to lecture about Tawheed, but to live Tawheed and to breathe Tawheed, this is something that I've only seen in Arbaeen. These emotions and these experiences are so, so, so exalted and elevated. You just have to come here yourself and experience them.
Media reports say more than 17 to 20 million people attend this walk each year. Even the lowest estimates reported by official sources are more than 5 times the number of people who perform Hajj in Mecca. But why? Why do millions of people from all over the world gather in a country that is often said to have extreme security risks? This is why.
كربلاء قد عدنا واشتياقا جدنا يا حسين يا حسين كلنا انصار كلنا زوار يا حسين يا حسين.
It is the love of Imam Husayn, the grandson of the last prophet of Islam, that keeps people going on this journey known as the Arbaeen Walk. Imam Husayn's shrine is their destination.
Karbala Imallah mein chelum mein tamam duniya ka koi mulk aisa nahi hai jahan Husayn ki bargah mein log पैदल चल के आ रहे हैं माए बच्चों के लिए वह हैं ज़ईफ इंसान सब एक ही सबकी एक ही धुन है किसी तरह से इमाम हुसैन के चौखट का बोसा दे के इमाम बीबी ज़ैनब को खराज अकीदत बीबी फातिमा ज़हरा को ताज़ियत पेश करें
दिखाई ये अली के खून की तासीर जैनब ने किया कातिल के घर में मातम शब्बीर जैनब ने कि जहां से कत्ल का शब्बीर के फतवा हुआ जारी जहां से कत्ल का शब्बीर के फतवा हुआ जारी वहीं रखी बिनाए मजलिस शब्बीर जैनब
Arbaeen literally means 40 in Arabic, marking the 40th day after Imam Husayn was martyred over 1200 years ago.
When somebody's heart is broken several times and they lose everything, but over 1200 years later, their love continues to flow and their heart continues to beat within the Ummah of Rasulullah and they're still shining a ray of light upon us, mere mortals. It just goes to show that Allah truly has preserved the Imams and their traditions, and we need to do more as Muslims to dialogue, to discuss, and to share our stories, because these stories are the definitions of our Islamic traditions.
Although Imam Husayn's status is greater in the Shia Islamic school of thought, he is also greatly valued by many Sunni Muslims.
So I've been with the Shia community for a long time. So, but not being a Shia, not calling myself a Shia, or not even, so it's just not about that, to be honest. But it just, you know, if I would say, it's a God-gifted thing, that if you have a love for Ahl-e Bayt alayhim salam in your heart, the true love for Ahl-e Bayt alayhim salam. So if you have a true love for Ahl-e Bayt alayhim salam, it just gets you. It's just like, you know, magnetic type of thing. It'll take you towards them. So this is what I feel. So I mean, I had the love for them. So this is why everything is getting open for me. So when the love, the more love I have in my heart, the more love is coming in my heart, the more getting closer. So this is how I found out. But this one, the first time Arbaeen, to be honest, if I even go out now again, if anybody asks me, I will literally tell them to please come, just for once, just guys, come and have a look. That the love for Imam Husayn alayhi salam is not just for the Shia peoples, not just for Shia community, it's for everybody.
It's really important for me to make it quite clear that those who come under the branch of Ahlul Sunnah, from the Asha'ira, from those who call themselves the Maturidiya, the Atariya, those who call themselves Sunni, you cannot be Sunni without a love for Ahlul Bayt.
Like Maulana Sahab said, I was listening, that it's for everybody, every Muslim being. It's not the Imam Husayn alayhi salam, not for just for one person, it's for everybody. For every Muslim being, for every whole, basically whole world. So if you guys come and have a look and just feel the love and feel the, because I think the love and then the peace and then the nice talk and the love the people give into this country, the way they welcome you, I think I never seen anywhere else in the world.
You can see the graves of the Maraji of Ahlul Sunnah, great Sayyids and thinkers buried only a few feet away from the Imams. We went to the noble grave of Imam Musa al-Khadim, rahimullah. And this is a shrine that is holy to both Sunni and Shi'i. That there are scholars, Tabi'een, individuals who my teachers would speak of, who would sit in the same confines of that space and think and reflect and make tadabbur. And for me, to be sat in that same place, where the scholars of the past were, where the Ahlul Bayt were, where the last generations were, I'm not worthy. And then to sit with scholars who are so senior in their school of thought, and to be allowed, to be chosen, to be accepted to come here and to be trusted, is something that I'm still not able to fathom truly. And wallahi, for my own iman, I needed this trip. Wallahu al-Azim, I needed this trip. And I am eternally grateful.
Now the Arbaeen Walk starts from the city of Najaf to Karbala, around 80 kilometers in distance. It takes around 4 to 5 days to reach Karbala on foot, so it is definitely not possible to walk that long without some rest.
So I did a walk before as well with some other, not for the this cause, but in back home in Pakistan. But it wasn't for some different scenarios in the college or school, and then some other work experience as well. But this was quite different. That when my sister, she said there's going to be a 3-day walk as well. Will you be able to do it? And if you can't do it, you can take a taxi and go for it. If you feel if you can't walk it, then you can take a taxi. I said, we'll see. Let me go and we'll see. I was thinking it might be difficult to be walking, because I heard so many people had blisters and some other things, people get ill as well. But luckily I didn't get no blisters, nothing else. In the walk, because I'm just trying to tell you one of the experience that I was on pole 1073, I think. Yeah, 1073. So when there is there was a guy who was giving the massage, because everybody get tired and they get a massage. So when I went there, had a massage. So I feel I asked another guy, do they accept hadiyah? This guy said yes. So I pull out some money and they tried to give him hadiyah. The guy left the massage and straight away said to me, please don't. We don't accept hadiyah. I said, okay. I tried to give it to another guy. He goes, no, wallahi brother, it's only we doing for Imam Husayn alayhi salam. And there I put my hands up, said no, I can't force them now, because this is their love for Imam Husayn alayhi salam, and this is my love for Imam Husayn alayhi salam that I'm walking. But when I realized that back in the days, the people did walk from that place to that place, but we had so many, you know, comforts, like we have a massages, we have people that come in and give him water, that give him food.
From the start of the walk till the end, it is close to impossible for anyone to starve on this journey. As soon as the pilgrims start walking, they're met with volunteers offering refreshments, drinks, massages, places to rest and sleep. You'll even find tailors and people repairing all sorts of things, from bags and shoes to wheelchairs and strollers. In addition to these, pilgrims will also find medical camps in every few minutes of their journey, in case they need any medical attention. This one is run by volunteers from India, working tirelessly to serve the pilgrims.
I'm here at Mokib Karwan Hind, pole number 327, and we are here to do the khidmat of all the Zawars who are walking from Najaf to Karbala. So this is pole number 327, and here we are going to do the work so that we can help the Zawars. Here we get cases of dehydration, high blood pressure, low blood pressure, blisters, people having lots of pain, sprain, back pain, all the muscular pulls. And also we have a massage tent where all the ladies, we have experts who are doing the massage, and we have students working with us. We have a nurse which is working with us. We have a doctor who's assisting us, and we have a translator who helps us to translate from Arabic. She tells us in English, and we have another translator also who translates from Farsi to English. Alhamdulillah, this Mokib has progressed a lot with the help of Imam Husayn alayhi salam, and you know, the love of all the lovers of Imam Husayn alayhi salam who have helped us with the donations. And because it was a very small place when we started it, and now it's become very huge. Here we are, it's not just that Mokib is only for Indian people, it's for everybody. People all over the country are visiting us, India, America, London, Iraq, Iran, everybody. We have not labeled it as an Indian Mokib, only for Indian people, it's for everybody. Here is everybody who all over the world are most welcome. We are at the service 24/7. We serve medical services, but we also serve food 24/7. Tea and a rest, everything is possible, alhamdulillah. A very great experience which I had never experienced in my life. When I see all these people, although they are suffering from all the aches and pains and all the blisters, but yet they say we want to walk and we have to reach from Najaf to Karbala. Even if our blood pressure is high, even if it is low, even if we have so many aches, pains, muscle pull, yet old people with, you know, diabetics, hypertensives, all say we want to walk from Najaf to Karbala. I have not heard anybody saying that although I am sick, I don't want to go. This is the spiritual, it's a spiritual upliftment of the people. Here you see the people just for the love of Imam Husayn alayhi salam, they are ready to bear with all the difficulties because they say we want to experience what Imam alayhi salam had experienced. So when I see all these people, I say that I think I should even walk, which I have never done in my life, inshallah. So I even have that, you know, I have a wish that even I should walk from Najaf to Karbala.
I am Saleha Badami, a medical student, a fourth year medical student. Inshallah, I'll be completing my medical degree very soon. I am coming from the last past 4 years, alhamdulillah, to help with my parents who are a doctor over here, who are serving Zawars of Imam Husayn alayhi salam. I must tell you that it's a very different experience. Being a medical student, seeing thousands of patients all over the world, but yet I cannot get so much of experience what I've experienced over here being in this camp. You get to see all types of patients, yet they feel that I will do anything just to reach the shrine of Imam Husayn alayhi salam. I'm very thankful to first and foremost Imam Zaman alayhi salam for selecting me among the ones to serve Imam Husayn alayhi salam. Because this is not an opportunity that everyone gets. This only if he selects, then he will be blessed. So this, I had never dreamt in my life that I will be able to, that studying medical will give me so much of helpful to help a Zawar of Imam Husayn alayhi salam. I never thought in my life ever that medical studies, I would come and serve you. Always I would think that, I wanted always to become a doctor, but never ever thought that I can serve the Zawars of Imam Husayn alayhi salam. But Alhamdulillah, from the first year I've entered, and always I had a wish, it was my wish that anything I can do for Imam Husayn, even if it's sweeping the floor, not necessarily that I have to only be a doctor or something that to help them, do anything just to help the Zawars of Imam. But Alhamdulillah, from the time I've entered medical college, Imam Husayn alayhi salam has called me over here to help the Zawars, to try to do whatever knowledge I have started with, to help me with that knowledge to serve the Zawars of Imam Husayn alayhi salam.
Some of these medical camps even give special attention to mental health.
Alhamdulillah, توفیق شد امسال تونستیم یه بخش به غرفه هایی که داشتیم اضافه بکنیم و اونم ایستگاه خدمات روانشناختی و مشاوره هستش که الان ملاحظه می‌فرمایید. این غرفه این هستش که در مسائل مربوط به مباحث روانشناختی، حالا اهم از مباحث روانشناختی که حالا عمومی هستش، مباحث ازدواج، مباحث کودک و نوجوان، مشاوره پیش از ازدواج، اینا مسائلی هستش که ما اینجا خدمات رو ارائه میدیم. ولی همینطور که مستحضر هستید، پیاده روی اربعین علل خصوص ایستگاه ها طوری نیستن که بشه گفت اینجا قرار مثلا درمانی صورت بگیره و اینا، نه قطعا این منطقی نیست و خودمونم قبول داریم که همچی کاری صورت نخواهد گرفت. اما این ایستگاه ها در حد یه مشاوره و راهنمایی خیلی میتونن مؤثر باشن و در حال راهگشا باشن و اثرگذار باشن و الحمدلله با استقبال گرم مردم، با محبت گرم مردم روبرو شدیم و سال به سال الحمدلله این غرفه ها استقبال مردم میگن بیشتر میشه و همین میطلبه که ما بتونیم کیفیت کار رو بیشتر بکنیم. ایستگاه های مشاوره و غرفه های مشاوره که الان مستحضر هستید محدود به مسیر طریق الحسین علیه السلام نمیشه. ایستگاه های مشاوری که مشاورین محترم از قم، از مرکز مشاوره معوا که زیر نظر مؤسسه آموزشی پژوهشی امام خمینی واقع در قم، از اونجا دوستان تشریف آوردن، بخشی از دوستان در نجف اشرف مشغول مشاوره هستن و برخی از دوستانم در طریق الحسین علیه السلام و بخشی از دوستانم در کربلا مشغول مشاوره و خدمات روانشناختی خدمت زوار هستن. و همونطور که گفتم، باز هم تاکید میکنم، اینه که صرفاً در اینجا در حد یه راهنمایی و مشاوره به زوار که بتونیم یه راهنمایی بکنیم و اگر مواردی باشد که نیاز به بررسی بیشتر باشه و حتی نیازمند به جلسات درمان باشه، حتما ما ارجاع میدیم تا ارجاع کنن پس از برگشت از سفر و زیارتشون، انشالله ارجاع میدیم به مراکز درمانی تحت مشاوره باشن و بتونن مشکلشون رو انشالله به لطف و توفیق خداوند متعال حل بکنن.
When it comes to Karbala, you see utmost humanity among the people. You see people giving out food, giving out shelter. Just today, I saw people ironing the clothes of the Zawar in the street for free. Where in the world do you see such things happening for free? It just doesn't happen. It's impossible to find that kind of an environment, especially with this many people. There are tens of millions of people inside this city, and yet they're treating each other like a family. When was the last time that you saw a stranger and you just said, hey, here's some food, you want to sleep here? Do you need anything? Let me give you a massage. You must be tired. Where do you see that kind of behavior? Only here. Only here. Only here. In other parts of the world, in fact, even here in other times of the year, you're not going to see compassion between two people if they cannot even communicate. They speak completely different languages, for example. And yet here, you see people, even if they can't speak the same language, they'll be like, do you want this food? Hada. You know, they'll try to be safe. Let me give you something. Let me help you. What is this language that they're speaking? It's not Arabic, it's not Farsi, it's not English, it's not Urdu. It's the language of humanity. It's a language that you'll only find here in Karbala. Karbala.
ये वॉक इसमें आप अहले सुन्नत को भी देखते हैं इसमें दूसरे मज़ाहिब के लोग भी हैं क्रिश्चियंस भी हैं दूसरे लोग भी आते हैं और वो इस चीज़ को देखते हैं जिनका रिलीजन इस्लाम भी नहीं है वो भी आते हैं वो इस कैफियत को इस चीज़ों को इस मोहब्बतों को दर्क करते हैं तो ये इंटरफेथ भी है दूसरे मज़ाहिब को भी जोड़ रही है और ख़ुद इस्लाम के अंदर भी जो मुख्तलिफ सेक्ट्स हैं उनको भी जोड़ रही है क्योंकि यहाँ रास्ते में आपसे कोई ये पूछता नहीं है तुम कौन हो तुम कहाँ से आए हो तुम कहाँ रहते हो नहीं वो सिर्फ ये जानता है कि ये ज़ाहिर है इमाम हुसैन चाहे कोई भी है अब वो उसी आइडेंटिटी से तो ये बहुत बड़ा प्लेटफॉर्म है कि जिसमें हम वहदत मुस्लिमीन पे भी काम कर सकते हैं वहदत अदियान पे भी काम कर सकते हैं और वहदत मोमिनीन तो वैसे भी हमारी बहुत शदीद ज़रूरत है और हम उसके लिए काम कर भी रहे हैं और अपने आपस में काम भी करने की जरूरत है।
One of the beautiful manifestations of love, forgiveness and friendship visible in this walk is the fact that despite an 8-year war resulting in slain countrymen, bitterness, bombs, destroyed buildings, houses and land, Iraqi and Iranian volunteers work together to ensure the walk is carried out peacefully and smoothly.
Iraq in recent years has seen the downfall of Saddam. Prior to that, it saw an 8-year war with Iran where Saddam dropped chemical weapons. Children until today are still being born with physical abnormalities off the back of the chemical weapons. After that, of course, came ISIS, Daesh. Sadly, Iraq has been through multiple stages of an ongoing war to completely decimate this country.
بعضی از بچه ها رو آقا خط کشید بعضی از بچه ها رو آقا خط بعد عملیات دقیقا بچه های توی این عملیات شهید شده بودن که آقا تو اون رویای صادق زیر اسمشون رو من هم خستم
So one of the things that I have to say I was pleasantly surprised to see was the unity among people. You do see an actualization of the verse of the Holy Quran where Allah says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا where Allah says, you know, hold on to the rope of Allah all together and be not disunited. Now, what is that rope of Allah? There are various interpretations amongst the ulama. One of them is that it is the Ahlul Bayt. And that's the beautiful thing that you see over here. Imam Husayn really brings people together. You'll see that these people who have almost nothing in common, they are very, very different people. Iraqis and Iranians, for example, very different people in very many different ways. I don't want to go into the details. But then you have lots of Pakistanis. On the same trip, you have lots of Indians. Pakistanis and Indians have a lot in common, and yet, you know, they have their differences. And then you have people coming from Sweden. I think I saw a Dutch flag. I saw people from Turkey. I saw people from Azerbaijan. All of these people, and obviously people who follow different marjas. And there are even people here who are not even Shia, are not even Muslim. And yet what happens? They're all united. Because the message of Imam Husayn is a message of unity. It is a message of Imam, of humanity, and that is something that unites human beings in principle.
The existence of an annual walk with such a high number of participants from diverse backgrounds, not only walking together peacefully, but also being catered for by citizens of an economically poor country, in itself is a huge blow to world capitalism. It serves as an embarrassment to countries like the United States and the United Kingdom, who, despite having the world's largest economies, cannot handle their extreme poverty issues.
One misconception that might be there in the minds of some is regarding how these millions of people are being catered for, right? It's really, really significant that these millions of people who are coming and walking, right? No government is paying for their food. No government is paying for their accommodation. It's all people. People pay to come here. People travel to come here. People walk for months just to make this walk. They're not being paid by anyone. In fact, they'll pay out of their own pockets to be here and make this walk. Their hosts, the Iraqi people, they'll save up the entire year to give everything to the visitors of Imam Husayn alayhi salam. Their country isn't in the best of situations. They don't have the best of economies. But they'll make sure, no matter what the situation, no matter how much political unrest there may be in the country, no matter how much oppression they may be facing, they'll make sure when it's Arbaeen, they are ready to give everything for the visitors of Imam Husayn alayhi salam. Right? There is no government involved in this, and no government's able to do that to people.
To see, after several wars, wars that I studied only a few years ago as a degree student at university, these victims of these same wars opening their hearts for the love of Ahlul Bayt, for the love of the Messenger of Allah and his flag, feeding us, honoring us, people from all around the world with their various banners, sleeping in extremely simplistic accommodation, but being so loving, being so understanding. There were certain motives that we went into where I felt like I was in Pakistan, I was in East Africa, I was in Sham, because of how open people were, how open they were with their food and their blankets and their love. And quite often people recognize that this guy kind of looks Sunni, he's wearing a lot more white than most of us are, and yet I receive so much love and affection.
لوای شیخ زکزاکی بزرگ شده بحثان تا دیگه امام زمان پهم کرده
Such selfless acts of love seem hard to believe, as we often hear about violence and sectarian conflicts in the region. Unless it is spoken about in your community, it is quite likely that you haven't even heard about the Arbaeen Walk before. This is because the mainstream media often only covers conflict in the region.
I didn't see anything on the media about Arbaeen at all. Quran talks about how media can be a construct used by the pharaonic powers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Al-Qasas, chapter 28, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Inna Fir'auna wa Hamana wa Janudahuma kanu khati'een. That Pharaoh and Haman, they have two armies. One of them is the literal army, where there's tanks and guns and swords and arrows, and the other one is their media wing. I didn't see anything on the media about Arbaeen. From one perspective, it's not the job of the media to be able to portray our religion to the world. On the other hand, when you have what is the largest gathering in the world, the largest pilgrimage in the world, and definitely the largest Muslim pilgrimage in the world, of which we are told this year there are some 16 million people that came in total, the media has to stand up and pay attention. The fact that they're not, it becomes upon us to spread the message for them. And that's how we do so, by bringing new guests every year, by using our social media platforms, by doing documentary like this. So inshallah, it's not the end, it's the beginning. and we can actually become our own media voice and spread the message to the entirety of the world. I think the fact that the mainstream media doesn't want to show something like this, in a way it's actually better, because I wouldn't want them to hijack it or to kind of put their own understanding on it, which might be wrong. It's better that we express the real meaning of Imam Husayn alayhi salam for ourselves to the rest of the world.
A Washington Post study found that most of the negative language in news articles using the word Muslim or Islam were about security concerns or set in foreign locations, as foreign stories are especially likely to focus on violence and war.
Right, so it was really interesting actually, because before I came to Arbaeen this year, the news was full of protests and violence and this unrest and that unrest. Every time I would just type in Iraq in Google and just, you know, click the news tab and scroll down, it was quite worrying, the situation that they portrayed of the events unfolding. But now that I'm here, nothing like that is happening. Actually, I'm seeing a lot of collaboration between Iranians and Iraqis. I'm seeing a lot of peaceful coordination, which was contrary to expectations due to the mainstream media's lies.
And the reason the media is doing that is because we know that Islamophobia is on the rise, you know, it's constantly rising, and they're trying to divide communities, not only between Shia and Sunni, but also other religions, you know, Christians, Muslims, atheists. And the image they're trying to portray of Muslims, especially in this day and age, is one of hate, one of a backwards mentality. And that is not true. It's far from the truth, to be honest.
Simply searching Arbaeen Walk or Iraqi pilgrims on mainstream news media sites like the New York Times or BBC bring up headlines with a negative connotation, or nothing at all.
The smallest thing happens in the world, they report it. The smallest, most insignificant thing takes place, they make documentaries about it, they make series about it, they make sure people know about it, make a commotion about it. But the biggest gathering, the biggest annual gathering of mankind in the world is something they just seem to forget about, right? The past years, there's hardly been coverage. There's been no coverage or close to no coverage whatsoever. This year, some media channels have gone a step further. They're trying to make people think bad about Arbaeen. They're trying to make people have a negative impression about this huge phenomenon that's taking place. And this shows that Arbaeen's working, dear brothers and sisters. It shows it's working. It shows that the media stations, which are unfortunately in the hands of individuals and institutions that don't like Islam very much, they're bothered by Arbaeen. They're trying to cover Arbaeen. They're trying to cover the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just as He promises, says in the Quran, they want to put out the light of Allah with their tongues, but Allah will perfect His light even if the disbelievers dislike that. And we're seeing it. No matter how much they try to hide it, no matter how much they try to defame it, Arbaeen is becoming bigger and bigger every year, and it will continue to become bigger and bigger every year.
The grand event of the Arbaeen, which is the 40th day of the martyrdom of Imam Husayn alayhi salam, is a way for us to be able to prepare for the zuhur of Imam al-Zaman, Imam al-Mahdi. And this is done in a whole variety of ways, a whole bunch of different ways. For example, we see that millions of people from all across the world, coming from different nations, different colors, different tribes, different nationalities, come together and join under the one banner, the one flag of Imam al-Husayn. And in the same manner, we see that during the zuhur, the reappearance of Imam al-Zaman, it is people from all over the world, all corners of the globe, whom will come together under the banner of Imam al-Zaman, Imam al-Mahdi, who will preach the message of truth and justice. He will preach the message of equality and fairness, social justice, economic equality for all. And it is under this message that millions of people from all across the world will come and join.
تو میانه ی خیل عزایی و من همه جا بروم به بهانه ی تو.
And similarly, in this event of Arbaeen, we find that everybody is very friendly, everybody is patient. It's not easy to pack 27 million people or more in such a small confined place. The Iraqi brothers on their behalf have been one of the best hosts imaginable, feeding countless millions of people whom they have never seen. And this again is preparation for the advent of the Zuhur of our Imam, who will come to preach this message of love and peace and justice and unity. And again, in the same manner, we will see that the people all across the world will live together in peace and in unity.
Now, the growing awareness of the Arbaeen Walk would be quite problematic for oppressive governments. This is because there are many stands, banners, placards, huge mokibs dedicated to talking about the oppression that takes place around the world, particularly the oppression caused by the United States, Israel, and their allies.
When you participate in the walk, you also get this feeling very much, it's very much like something that's you could say, you know, tangible, that, you know, people are showing that they're preparing for the coming of the Imam, who will be the source of spreading justice throughout the world. And they are taking a stance against, you know, the oppressors of the time. That can be seen even through some of the slogans that are there, some of the quotes. Many of the quotes that have been put up show some of the deeper messages of the tragedy of Ashura, and some of the scholars and their quotes as well too. They're talking about how this is the contemporary message of Ashura. You can see even in some of the videography that is being displayed on the walk as well too, that aims to link, you know, the historical events to the current events, and to show that it's the same movement that's there back then and the same movements that are there right now. And so, you know, we can say that just like we had, you know, Imam Husayn alayhi salam, the person at that time, and we had Yazid and everything he represented as a person at that time, you know, we have the movement of Imam Husayn and the leaders that represent Imam Husayn at this time, and we have the movement of Yazid and those, you know, figureheads and those arrogant powers that represent him in this era.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اسمي أمير عمار من مدينة الكاظمية احنا اليوم بخيم موكب العراقي دعم اليمن الموكب تأسيس حديث التأسيس أساس فكرة المخيم هو إيصال الدعم للشعب اليمني اللي صار ما أكثر من 4.5 سنوات تحت الحصار لا أكل يدخل لهم لا ماء صالح للشرب يدخل لهم من ماء صالح للشرب ماكو يعني امراض ماي غير صالح للشرب يعني امراض كوليرا ماكو علاجات طبيه فالشعب صار اليمني يموت بسبب الجوع والعطش والمرض وكذلك شفنا القصف اللي يصير على الشعب اليمني والمجازر اللي تصير على الشعب اليمني فهي بدت فكره المخيم وموكب العراقي دعم اليمن فكره مع مجموعه الشباب ما يتعدون عددهم 4 فمدينة الكاظمية فاجتمعنا ببيت من البيوت وصار فكرة المخيم بأن يصير أكو جانب عراقي وجانب يمني كنا نعرف بأن مسيرة كربلاء ومسيرة الإمام الحسين وليش الإمام الحسين ثار ضد الظالم بأن أكو فد شخص حاول يذل الدين الإسلامي حاول يشوه صورة الدين الإسلامي والإمام ثار ضده كذلك الصورة تجسد باليمن بأن يعني المقولة إمام الحسين من يقول ألا وأن الدعية من الدعية قد ركز بين اثنتين بين السلة والذلة وهي هات من الذلة. كذلك شعب اليمن من حاول يطلب أبسط حق له هو إصلاح النظام أو إصلاح بعض الأمور السياسية وإذا بالنظام السعودي والتحالف دولي صار وأمريكا ودخلت جميع الدول دخلت بها ضد هذا الفئة القليلة وضد هذا الشعب البسيط اللي لا يملك حتى أبسط شيء هو تكرمون الحذاء ما يملكون يقاتلون يعني يقاتلون الدبابات يقاتلون المدرعات الأمريكية السعودية اللي تعتبر هي السعودية من أكثر الدول التسليحية صرف على السلاح ما يقارب $7 مليارات بالسنة بس صرفها على السلاح. يعني تتخيل بأن هذا الإنسان اللي شايل كلاشينكوف مزنجرة يوقف ضد الدبابة ضد مدرعة ضد طيارات ضد هليكوبترات ضد صواريخ كل أنواع الصواريخ هذا الصمود البطولي ولا بهذا الوقت حتى نشوف بأن عمليات هجومية بأن اليمن قام مو بس يصد قام أمين يهجم يعني شلون الفكرة الحسينية بأن ثبتت وأثمرت باليمن كون إحنا مو بس ندعمهم كون همين نتعلم من عندهم الصمود كيف إنسان يقول هيهات من الذلة. الشيء اللي يثير السخرية بأن السعودية كل ما زادت بالقصف كل ما زادت بأساليب التعذيب أساليب الوحشية الصواريخ الفسفورية نشوف بأن الشعب اليمني توحد أكثر. الشعب اليمني كلنا يعرف بأن هم عبارة عن عشائر منفصلة متفرقة كذا طوائف سنة شيعة كذا فكل ما زادت الأساليب السعودية بالتعذيب والوحشية زاد توحد اليمن كل اليمن توحد بكلمة واحدة بأن هذا عدو وهذا صديق.
So we see that Imam Husayn alayhi salam, his stand, which occurred almost 1400 years ago, this stand of Imam Husayn alayhi salam is not something that is confined to a specific time, a specific area or a country. It's not specific to a certain age in history. Rather, the stance of Imam Husayn alayhi salam is for all ages and all times, and thus it applies to today's time. In a world today where we see countless forms of oppression and tyranny. We see dictatorships from the east all the way to the west. We find injustice on massive levels. If we zoom in, we can talk about examples such as Yemen, where almost 14 million people are on the brink of starvation. We see countless millions in the nation of Syria whom have been made homeless due to aggressive wars that have been imposed on them. We also find in other parts of the world, whether it is the Muslims of Myanmar, whom were being burned alive, or we see the current events in Kashmir, where the people of Kashmir are under a total communication blackout, while the government continues to do killings and massacres. At the same time, we see that the people of the Islamic Revolution of Iran, the Islamic Republic, is under attack due to unjust sanctions only because they are looking for self-determination and the right which every human being has. When we see the stance of Imam Husayn alayhi salam against oppression and against injustice in his time, it teaches us that in our time, we too must stand up bravely and courageously against the oppression and injustice which is occurring in our very own world. My dear friends, my dear brothers and sisters, if we do not find the courage to stand up against oppression, against tyranny, against this injustice on a global level, then I assure you that the world will be destroyed at the hands of these arrogant, bullying powers which are trying to dominate and control the globe.
And in this very spirit, pictures and stories of martyrs killed for fighting injustice for the sake of Allah are spread out across the walk. Some mokibs even specifically focus on these personalities to inspire others.
نحن في مخيم الشهداء مخيم صدقوا اسم مأخوذ من الآية القرآنية صدقوا بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم صدقوا معاهد الله عليه فمنهم من قضى نحبه ومنهم من ينتظر وحلوا حقا الشهداء هم من صدقوا مع الله. المخيم هنا في طريق المشاية عمود 1086 عندي احمل عده رسائل مخيم يشمل على سير ذاتيه لبعض الشهداء تعريفهم بعده لغات عربي فارسي وانجليزي غرض تعريف شهدائنا الكرام وكذلك شهداء من جنسيات مختلفه شهداء ايرانيين ولبنانيين كذلك نوع من الشكر وكذلك ذكر لهم الذين سقطوا في العراق شهداء كذلك شاركونا في المعارك المخيم في هذا الطريق يعني يحمل عده رسائل منها الربط بين المسيره الحسينيه وبين الشهداء هذه مسألة مهمة بأن شهداؤنا هم امتداد للمسيرة الحسينية هذا جانب جانب آخر استذكار لشهدائنا الأبطال الذين بدمائهم بفضل دمائهم ببركات دمائهم اليوم المسير آمن اليوم المسيرة مستمرة هذا جانب جانب آخر نقطة أخرى التحفيز الشباب المجتمع على أنه المعركة وأي مبادئ أي عقائد لا تستمر إلا بالتضحيات وكما المقولة المعروفة الحرمات تصان بالدماء الحرمات لا تصان إلا بالدماء فالحرمات تحتاج إلى دماء ومن الرسائل الأخرى نحن هنا بعض الشهداء من الجمهورية الإسلامية الإيرانية ولبنان نوع من الشكر لهم لحضورهم معنا في المعارك مساعدتهم لنا وبأنه نحن نستذكرهم ونشكرهم على وقوفهم معنا
نحو نصر الله كلام الله شاهد العزم واحد حين تقاتل نصرا نشاهد نصر وأكثر الله أكبر الحج تكبر الله أكبر الحج تكبر الله أكبر لله يثأر الحج
احنا عندنا صور شهداء من الجمهوريه الاسلاميه الايرانيه حج حميد تقوي وكذلك الشهيد محمد سلمان اللبناني اللي استشهدوا في العراق فنوع من الاستذكار لهم وكذلك نوع من بين الوحده بين الشيعه في هذا المسير وفي الدماء. احب ان نستثمر هذه الفرصه وجودكم ان نوجه رساله لاخوتنا وانفسنا بالاحرى لان نحن كشعب عراقي والشعب الايراني بغض النظر عن المشاكل التي ربما تعرفها اخوه وذو مصير واحد وهدف واحد ومصيرنا مرتبط بالاخر. احب ان اقولها لكل الزوار انهم اخوتنا في الدين اولا والشيء الاعلى من ذلك هم زوار الحسين سلام الله عليه. فكل الزائرين القادمين هم على رؤوسنا ونحن في خدمتهم لانهم يحملون عنوانا كبيرا وهو زائر الحسين سلام الله عليه. وهذا عنوان كبير فلا يتأثر ببعض بكلام بعض المرضى هناك بعض المرضى المدفوعين من قبل أمريكا وإسرائيل والسعودية وباقي دول الأعداء لنا هم هدفهم إيجاد الفتنة بين الشيعة بأي وسيلة وبأي طريقة ودفعوا مبالغ كبيرة ودفعوا بكثير من الناس ولكن إن شاء الله بفضل وبركة زيارة الأربعين إن شاء الله ستدحض وستفشل كل مخططاتهم هذه وكما في أصل الفتوى سماحة آيات الله العلماء سيدي السيسنا بأنها جهاد كفائي للدفاع عن الوطن والمقدسات ولم تكن فتوى جهاد لغرض مهاجمة مكان أو منطقة محددة فالغرض هو كان الدفاع ومن كما الحديث النبوي من قتل دون دمه أو أرضه أو عرضه أو ماله فهو شهيد فهم مصداق لهذا الحديث كذلك خرجوا ليدافعوا ودفاعهم ليس فقط عن العراقي وعن هذا البلد المغرب وإنما كان دفاعا عن الإنسانية لأن داعش كانت تستهدف كل الإنسانية ومن الظلم ومن الحقيقة الظلم الكبير والإجحاف بحقهم من نطارنا شهداءنا هذه شهداء وأرواحهم الطاهرة بمجرمي داعش كما يظن الإعلام الغربي يصور الإعلام الغربي البعض كأنما الحشد الشعبي هو شيء بالضد من بشيء يوازي داعش ولكن ذاك داعش لطائفة محددة ومذهب والحشد الشعبي لمذهب فهذه فكرة غير صحيحة لأن الحشد الشعبي والمجاهدين والشهداء الذين سقطوا دافعوا عن العراق وعن المقدسات وعن الإسلام ودافعوا عن الإنسانية جمعا ولم يدافعوا عن مذهب أو طائفة محددة.
It is clear that the Arbaeen Walk has many different elements including peace, love, humanity, forgiveness, sacrifice, selflessness, and Islamic activism. Lots and lots of opportunities for someone to perfect themselves through this journey towards Imam Husayn. But how can one take full advantage of this experience in just a few days?
There are a number of things that somebody can do in order to take full advantage of the Arbaeen Walk. And in fact, we could look at it this perspective, that however much we get the opportunity to perform the Arbaeen Walk, each time can be an effort to try to gain more and more of it. Because I do believe that however much somebody takes from it, there's even more that they can take the next time around. Part of the way to be able to get that benefit is by observing the adab of the walk. There's certain etiquette that can be practiced. Things like making sure that somebody is in the state of constant remembrance of Allah Ta'ala. Also in particular, in remembrance of the one or the ones that they're going to be visiting, by taking care of their fellow zuwar, by treating them with a lot of respect, not pushing, allowing them to pass, for example, by not being overly engaged with like the sights and the sounds and the different offerings that are being given along the walk, by trying to walk in with a demeanor that somebody is, you know, going towards something great. And that means that, for example, trying to keep the head a little bit more down and trying to walk in a dignified manner. Also by not engaging in worldly sort of discussions and trying to keep in the state of wudu as well. And a few others that I mentioned, it's worth studying this thing and to see what is it that the ulama have recommended, what type of adhkar and what type of remembrance of Allah did the great scholars like Sayyid Qadi Tabatabai perform when they went on the walk. These are things that we should research and ask the scholars and try to find out.
All during this walk, it would all be a complete spiritual engagement with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Ahlul Bayt. Of course, someone like me is not going to be able to, you know, make this walk and not speak at all. However, what we can do is at least try to maybe joke a little bit less. You know, spend a little bit less time speaking about useless things and concentrate.
If you look at the traditions of the Ahlul Bayt, they talk about the reward of walking to perform ziyarah and how much reward each footstep can bear for the person who's performing them. It's tremendous. And there's something that the Ahlul Bayt wanted for us to achieve. So trying to make sure that we understand that perspective. What am I doing? Why am I doing it? Whom am I going to see? The more that we understand the position of the Ahlul Bayt, the more our ma'rifah increases and our awareness increases, then the more that the walk will have meaning. But of course, in order to understand the position of Ahlul Bayt, we have to understand the position of Allah Ta'ala and consequently the position of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And then we can start to begin to understand the position of the Ahlul Bayt. But even that, of course, is at a certain rudimentary level. And we hope that by virtue of the ziyarah, that the true knowledge will be given to us about the position of the Ahlul Bayt. So by number one, observing the adab. By number two, increasing our awareness and ma'arifah of what we're doing, why we're doing it, and who we're going to deserve.
Red box. There's a few other personalities and a few other saris that you will see. One is at the one side of the grave of Imam Husayn.
Why is it important to visit him? What makes this event so, so important? Its relationship with ourselves as individuals, ourselves as an ummah and all humanity, both the past and the future, right? And I think something that we should think about while taking part in this amazing journey is to try to find our role in the movement of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam. When we enter the shrine of Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam, it shouldn't only be an empty salam. It shouldn't only be an expression of emotion about what happened in the past, but rather it should be an expression of devotion and of resolution that I will do everything I can to make sure that your movement continues and reaches the entire world.
Duras Vatan Boy, 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 Boy
کشته دور از وطن دور از وطن وای دور از وطن وای دور از وطن وای کشته دور از وطن دور از وطن وای.
Don't make touching the shrine your purpose, which is, I think, something that we often fall into. It's a trap that we often fall into. It's not about, it's not a mission for you to touch the shrine. Even if you stand outside and you say salam, but you say it with khulus, then you have, I'd say that you have reached to an extent making the most of your trip here. Your trip here is supposed to take whatever you have become so far and push yourself to the limit. Recognize that you're here surrounded by people from all over the world, and learn from their experiences, learn from what they have gone through in life. Many of us, when we come here, we stay in hotels. Many of us who come here don't have that luxury. When you are walking amongst these people, you need to try, and I'm speaking to myself before anybody else out there, you need to try to see yourself as part of them. It's as if we're all blood vessels, and every path, every literal road full of people leading to the shrine of Imam Husayn is like a vein. And you can see the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam materializing here, because he said that the ummah is like a body. If one part of it aches, the rest of it will also, you know, they'll stay awake out of fever and unrest until that part of the body is healed. Many of the people who come here in for Arbaeen, they're suffering. They are oppressed people. And I think one of the ways to take full advantage of this trip is to recognize the trials and tribulations of our fellow mu'mineen out there in the world, and to be touched by them. Many people, they say, will walk in and out of your heart, but only a true friend will leave footsteps. Allow the people on this path to leave footprints in your heart.
The only power that's able to make this happen is love. Is love. It's only one thing which makes Arbaeen happen, which makes this walk happen, and that's love. Pure, true love. If you want to experience that love, you have to come for Arbaeen.
هر قدم هر نفس هر تپش دم بگیر.